Welcome everyone to our YouTube series, Test Prep Made Easy. So in this particular series, we are going to post regularly questions on our YouTube channel. The questions may pertain to CAT preparation, may be pertaining to GMAT preparation, as well as of various topics which are tested in these particular exams. For example, quants, LRDI, English, and various areas which are tested. And each day, we will handle certain number of questions and their video solutions. The best approach is to these questions in these videos. So have a happy preparation ahead and enjoy the video. Thank you.
All right, so these are the questions that we are going to try in today's video. If you have tried it already from the thumbnail, good enough. If you haven't, you can pause the video at this point and try it once before you look into the solutions. We recommend you doing that. But if you just want to enjoy the solution, that's also good enough. And go ahead and watch the solutions now. All right. So we are looking for number of integers from 1 to 100, which can be written as a product of two distinct prime numbers. Before I get into the counting, let me give you few information here. This is something I mentioned in our classes. So first thing, what I'm telling you is the number of prime numbers in certain ranges. If you remember, it will be useful in these kind of questions. So 1 to 10, there are 4 prime numbers. 11 to 20, there are 4 prime numbers. Only in these 10 numbers, I mean, if you take a gap of 10 numbers, only in these 10, you will find 4 prime numbers. You'll never have 4 prime numbers in any 10 other numbers. 1 to 50, there are 15 prime numbers. 1 to 100 will not be required in this question, but just because I was mentioning this, let me tell you this as well. So 1 to 100, there are 25 prime numbers. So you can remember these two in different ways as well, but this is something I find easy to keep a check of. So 15 and 25, these two are the important ones. These two you can remember, as I mentioned earlier, only couple of 10 numbers in which you'll find 4 prime numbers. But yeah, this will be useful in counting for this question, but let me now get into the counting part. So if you count these kind of things with an order, it's always useful to avoid double counting and those kind of mistakes. So what I'm going to do is I'll start with indicating the number as n, and let me take a case where n is of the form 2 into some other prime number. Now when I'm saying 2 into some other prime number, what I'm going to think is the p is greater than 2, something like this. So all the p's that I'm going to count should be greater than 2. Now what is the constraint? So first of all, it has to be in the range 1 to 100, right? So it means that this 2p has to be less than 100. It can't even be 100, although inclusive 100 is not a prime number. 100 is not a product of two prime numbers. So 2p less than 100, you can take less than equal to, that is fine. So p has to be less than 50, right? So basically check this part out. So 1 to 50, we have 15 prime numbers, but that includes the 2, isn't it? So if you exclude the 2, there will be 14 other prime numbers which satisfy this condition. So something like 3 to 50. So 3 to 50, there will be 14 other prime numbers which will satisfy this condition. This is one case. Let us look at n is equal to 3 into some other prime number. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to take this in an order. So in this case, what I'm going to consider is, I'm going to consider p is greater than 3. The reason is, so think about the number 2 into 3. When you counted these set of numbers, 2 into 3 is already counted, right? So if you just consider that p is not equal to 3, then there's a chance that you can count 3 into 2 as well. But 2 into 3 and 3 into 2 are the same numbers. So you're counting the same number multiple times. So don't make that mistake. So let's always take it as the right factor, or the right-hand side factor is greater than the left-hand side factor, something like that. So just maintain an order. Left-hand side one smaller than the right-hand side. So just visually imagine that. So what you have is 3p less than 100. So p is less than 33.33 or something, right? So now you have to just brute force count a particular range. See, from 1 to 10 and 11 to 20, you already know there are 4 and 4 prime numbers. So 1 to 10, the 4 prime numbers that you have includes 2 and 3, so exclude that. So first of all, you have two numbers in this range, 5 and 7, of course. 11 to 20, there are 4, so you don't need to count that. All you have to do is just count from 21 to 33, how many prime numbers are there. Because P is a prime number any which way, right? So just check this out. So 23, 29, 31. These are the only other three prime numbers which are less than 33.33, right? So three other numbers. So just take a note of that. So you have three other numbers. So this particular case is satisfied by 2 plus 4 plus 3 that are 9 numbers, right? So you have 9 numbers in this case. Let's carry on with this. So again, I'm going to consider N as 5 into P and P greater than 5, of course. So 5P less than 100. So P less than 20. So P less than 20, they're just these 8 numbers, but out of which 2, 3 and 5, these prime numbers are already considered. You can check here as well. So just ignore those three prime numbers. So if effectively we have 8 minus 3, which are 5 prime numbers which satisfy this particular criteria. This is the last case that is going to happen. N is equal to 7 into P. Now in this case, you can count using this approach or just use a normal logic here. 7 into 11 is satisfying, 77. 7 into 13 is satisfying. If you consider 7 into 17 onwards, that is greater than 100, right? So there are just two numbers which satisfy this. So don't apply the same approach. You may apply, that is absolutely fine. You'll get 7P less than 100, P less than 14 points, whatever. So only 11 and 13 will satisfy because again, we are considering P greater than 7. So this is the approach. By the way, as I mentioned earlier, no other case will satisfy because if you just follow the same thing, the next prime number that we have is 11. But if you consider 11 into P, remember we have to consider P greater than 11 because numbers like 7 into 11, 5 into 11, those have been counted already, right? 3 into 11 here, 2 into 11 here, those have already been counted. So P greater than 11, that means that this thing is greater than 11, multiplied to 11, how can you get less than 100? So this is anyhow not possible, right? So you don't have to consider any more cases. So just add all of these numbers. So you have 14 here, 9, 5 and 2. These are the possibilities. 9 plus 5 is also 14. Couple of 14 is 28 plus 2 is 30. So option B should be the answer here. So this is a structured way of counting. If you do remember this block, it helps in a lot of different questions. In our classes, I do mention another level as well, 1 to 246. But I do mention that I've never found this useful in any particular exam. But just for the sake of it, I mentioned one extra level, that's all. If you remember till this point, it is sufficient for most of the exams. So yeah, that's all for this particular question. Hopefully everything was understood. Thank you. Well, we have a cashier that has a sum of rupees 700 in total 27 notes. So total amount is given, total number of notes have also been given, and the denominations have also been provided. So yeah, there are a lot of variations on these types. So now there's an additional constraint. If the number of notes of rupees 5 is less than that of rupees 50 by at most 2 notes. Okay. So number of notes of rupees 5 is less than that of rupees 50 by at most 2 notes. So a couple of things mentioned here. I'll come to each of them. We are looking for what is the number of rupees 10 notes that the cashier can have. So a possibility, something like that. So how many number of 10 notes can he have? So this is something which simplifies if you form equations in the smartest way possible. So for this particular context, let me show you how to do this. So the rupee 50 ones, I'm considering there are X notes. So this is a number of notes. Rupees 5 one, I'm considering as Y number of notes. Now, a couple of reasons to this. One reason is I'm looking for number of 10 notes. So if I can adjust some possibilities for X and Y, accordingly, whatever is the remaining, I'll assign it for 10. But more importantly than that is because of the constraint out here. So this part, if the number of notes of rupees 5 is less than, so this is talking about rupees 5 and rupees 50, right? So I'm focusing more on those two notes rather than the rupees 10 notes. So as I was mentioning, so rupees 10, will basically be 27 minus x minus y, right? Because you have a total of 27 nodes. So this is the assumption. Let me utilize the total amount given and write one equation out here. So all the 50 rupees notes added, so you'll have 50x as the total amount. You'll have 5y as the total amount from 5 rupee notes. And this adds up to 10 times of this entire thing. This total is 700, all of this added. By the way, this is a multiple of 5. So let me just quickly evaluate this. You can follow and do the steps yourself. So I'll get something like 10x when I divide this by 5. I'll have a minus of 2x, so I'll be left with 8x. When I divide this by 5, I'll have y, and this will be minus 2y, so I'll have a minus y. This divided by 5 will be 140, and this will be 54. So 140 minus 54 is 86. So if you find trouble in doing this, so you can just write an additional step, but this is what you'll come to. So you'll have 8x minus y is equal to 86. So this is one thing that we know about x and y. What other things do we know? So one is, of course, this x minus y. So if you read this constraint, if the number of nodes 5 is less than that of 50 by at most 2. So x minus y, x is the 50 ones and y is the 5 ones. So x minus y can be maximum of 2, right? So something like this, x minus y is less than equal to 2. And of course, if this is the number of 50 rupee notes and this is the number of 5 rupee notes and the total number of notes are 27. So the x plus y can never exceed 27, right? So these are the couple of constraints that we have. So let us look into the solution. I hope everybody knows how to figure out integral solutions of these types. So that is what I'm going to focus on, because x, y, all of these have to be integers, the number of nodes. So in this case, I'm looking for a multiple of 8. So for 86, that is a multiple of 8, which is just above 86, because I'm going to subtract y from that. So 88 should be pretty obvious to you. So I can pick x as 11, in which case y can be 2, right? So 11, 88 minus 2, that is 86. So this qualifies. So now let us validate the constraint. So 11 minus 2 is actually 9, which is greater than 2. So this is the constraint I'm looking for. So this is not allowed. Now the next solutions are very easy, because there's a minus sign here. The x and y will both increase simultaneously. X will increase by coefficient of y and y will increase by coefficient of x. So just increase this by 1. So this is 12, and increase this by 8. So that is 10. Now 12 minus 10 is actually 2. So it is validating this particular constraint. So this is possible. So we're looking for possibilities any which way. But now I cannot, I can straight away say that I can't increase this further, because if I increase this by 1 and if I increase this by, if I increase this by 1, the x value, and I increase this by 8, then we have 31 nodes, right? So it is exceeding 27. So going beyond this is anyhow not possible. So this can have is sort of a trick in the question, because there is only one possibility which works out, and that is x is equal to 12 and y is equal to 10. But remember, we are looking for 10 nodes, which is this. So that is 27 minus this 22. All the remaining nodes. So basically 5 nodes of rupees 10. That is the only possibility out here. So nice question. So a lot of variations you'll find of these types. Just assume the variables in the smartest way possible. The easiest way you can assume the variables, of the fastest you can solve these kind of questions. So that's all my input for this particular question. Hopefully everything was understood. Thank you for joining in. All right, so we have an expression given to us. So we have this entire thing given to us. And we're looking for the sum of 1 cube, 2 cube, up to x cube. So when I'm looking for the sum of 1 cube to x cube, and I'm seeing there are obviously integral options, and even if there's not integral options, I mean, this is indirectly telling me that x is a integer, natural number, right? Great, so I'll keep that as an information as well. So x is a natural number. Let me just solve this. I don't think that was required, but anyhow, so 3x, so I'm not noticing this part. I'm noticing this 2, 5, 8, 68, and these things. So this is forming an AP, right? So let me focus on that to begin with. So 2, 5, 8, up to 68. So I want to get the summation of this AP. So first thing, first target is the number of terms. So number of terms will be 68 minus 2 by 3, the common difference, plus 1. So this will give me the number of intervals. Plus one will give me the number of terms. So this is the number of terms, right? Let me resolve this. So you have 66 by 3 is 22 plus 1. So 23 terms out here. And the average is the average of the first term and the last term, right? Because that's the average of an AP series. So you have 2 plus 68 divided by 2, which is 35. So if you add the constant bits out here, so the constants will add up to 23 into 35. I'm not multiplying this as of now, but this is what I'm going to have, right? So the reason I'm not multiplying, let me explain that also, because in each of these terms, you have these 3x, and we know now that there are total of 23 terms, right? So all of those 3x added will be something like 23 into 3x, right? So this is the entire summation on the left-hand side. Now, since I have a 23 common, and now, yeah, this comes actually in handy. So indirectly, I know that 1702 has to be a multiple of 23 in order for x to be an integer. So 1702 just divided by 23. On the face of it, this it doesn't seem that it will catch your eyes directly. But anyhow, if you divide by 1702, so I know that 161 is 23 into 7. So 1610 I can eliminate, and then 92, though, that is 4. So basically what I have is 74. So this is 74 into 23, right? So just eliminate the 23. So you have 3x as 74 minus 35, which is 39, implying x is equal to 13. So pretty simple way to figure out the value of x. And now just apply the summation formula. I hope you're aware of it. So 1 cube plus 2 cube up to 13 cube is what we are looking for, which is 13 into 13 plus 1 by 2 whole squared. So this is 7 into 13, 91, because 14 by 2 is 7. So 91 squared is what we are looking for, which is 8281. By the way, if you're not aware of 91 squared, observe that couple of things here. Last digit has to be 1, and it will be pretty close to 90 squared, right? 9591 seems a little away. 90 squared is 8100. So it should be pretty close to 8100 and the last digit of 1. So only one option will satisfy. But apart from that, I hope that you are aware of finding squares easily and all. So this is the answer for this question. And nothing too much to add to it. The additional things that I had to explain, I did explain while I was solving it any which way. So hopefully everything was understood. Thank you for joining in. All right, so pretty straightforward questions in PNC. We have to find the number of ways can the letters of this word abscond be arranged so that the ABC appear in alphabetical order. So whatever word we are forming, so A has to be before B and that has to be before C. So this order has to maintain, right? That is the alphabetical order. So in these kind of questions, you always have to look for how many distinct and identical you have. So here you will find that all the seven letters are distinct. So first think all the arrangements that you can have. So for these seven letters, there will be a total of seven factorial arrangement without this constraint, right? Now, just try to understand what this constraint is actually implying. So I'll just explain this a bit. So let me place everything apart from ABC. Randomly. So we have a S here, we have a O here, we have a D and an N. So something like this. Okay, I need one more position. So just randomly positioning these other four letters, which doesn't have a constraint. So just placing it randomly out here. So these three positions will be occupied by ABC in certain order, right? So just imagine the seven factorial arrangements. So out of which, when you have these four letters on these four positions, some of the cases in which ABC will occupy these three positions in random order. By random order, I mean, we can have a ABC here, we can have a ACB here, we can have a BAC, something like that. So all possible arrangements are feasible, right? In the seven factorial arrangement that you have considered. But consider how many are allowed out of them. So first of all, you have to understand how many are by default taken. So there are three positions for this ABC, out of which we are arranging without constraint. So when we are taking seven factorial, that is without constraint. So there will be a total of three factorial arrangements which have been counted. So something like have been counted. Now for each of these three factorial arrangements, there is only one arrangement which is allowed, and that is this one in our example, right? So A followed by B and then B followed by C. So out of every 3 factorial, there will be one allowed. So out of the 7 factorial, only 1/3 factorial arrangement should be allowed, right? So that is the idea of division any which way. So out of every 3 factorial, you have one. So symmetrically, this should be the answer for this question. If you cancel out the 3 factorial from 7 factorial, you'll be left with 7 into 6 into 5 into 4. So just calculate this much. 6 into 5 is 30, into 7 is 210, and then multiply 4 to it to get 840 as our answer. So option D. Pretty straightforward question. If you know this idea, this is like a 5-second problem or something. Nothing to it. I hope most of you have got the answer here. If you have not got it, do check out our capsules on permutation combination. If you're going for a full course, then any which way everything will be covered. But if you're just looking to, you know, balance out your PNC basics and everything, from basic to advanced everything, so we have a specific capsule for that. I'll leave the link in the description below, and do check that out. And we also have a blog written on the basics of counting in our website. So if you can visit that, that should also be helpful from the basics point of view. So this is entirety of my 2 cents for this particular problem. I hope everything was understood. Thank you for joining us.
Hopefully you liked the solutions we provided for these questions. And if you did like it, do not forget to like the video and share, subscribe and comment. Do subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon. In that case, you'll get notification as soon as we upload a new video. And if you want to check a bouquet of courses that we provide, so we have a huge variant of courses from customizability to full preparation, you can check our website www.mathoratory.com. I'll leave the link in the description below. And have an enjoyable preparation ahead. Welcome to the Mathoratory family and have a good exam ahead.